Publish and perish. Well, that's not the way it usually is supposed to go. It's supposed to be publish or perish. I'm going to take you through an incident, and I'm going to tell you right up front that I don't know everything that's going on, nor do most of the other people, and the people who really do know aren't saying too much. But we will do our best to peer through a glass darkly. I'm going to give you the sources first so that you can look up what you want to, and of course you can Google other sources if you want. I'm going to give you what I would call the unchallenged facts, that is the facts that one side asserts and the other side does not dispute or perhaps even agrees with. I'm also going to give you the disputed facts, where one side says one thing happened, one side says something else happened. And you can make up your mind as you look at all this, who's closer to the truth. I'm going to, of course, give you my evaluation first, and then I'm going to open it up for your evaluation. And in order to do that, I'm going to suggest that those of you who are interested enough take notes so that when we get done looking at all of the confusing data, that you can come back to the points that you were interested in. The first source that I'm going to introduce you to is the paper that is at the center of the brouhaha. Armitage and Anderson, soft sheets of fibrillar bone from a fossil of the supraorbital horn of the dinosaur Triceratops horridus, found in Acta Histochemica. That is, of course, part of the peer-reviewed literature, as we will find out. We will even run into one of the peers. The abstract is available. If you pay them a small fee, you can get the paper. However, it is also available for free thanks to researchgate.net, where authors put their papers up for personal interest. So that nowadays you can get around that $35 or whatever it is fee, and you don't have to belong to the university to do so. There are a number of comments. This first link is from a creationist source, Creation Evolution. The next two are one from way back when it started and one from behind, and this guy has made several comments. Sensuous curmudgeon, and he's kind of, shall we say, on the other side of the fence. But some of his posts are repetitious, but those two kind of give you a bracket on these other posts, and he'll have internal links for what it's worth, especially in the last one. Then there's an interesting post by Retraction Watch, which I was not aware was a creationist organization, and I'm still not sure it's a creationist organization, but it does seem to be kind of friendly to Armitage's position. Christian Times, which is kind of on the fence, actually probably more on the fence than Retraction Watch, which is interesting. Christian Examiner, again from the Christian standpoint. Inside Higher Ed, which is not from the Christian standpoint, but gives a surprisingly even-handed review of the situation. And the College Fix, which is, a conservative group. Now, for those of you who got the email, these are new, and we'll hopefully have them up when we go to actually put this online as links. Antievolution.org has an interesting conversation where you have hardliner evolutionists and softer-liner evolutionists who are arguing over whether Armitage should be fired or not. A guy by the name of Bob O.H. is actually pretty decent. And then there's a blog by drwiley.com, which has, you know, has the blog itself, but also has two comments made by Mark Armitage. So they're kind of primary material. Finally, I did a phone interview with Alan Reinach, who is Armitage's attorney. Not formal, but it gave me some idea of what was going on. And I wasn't able to talk to Mark Armitage himself. And then there's a link to the judge's preliminary decision that declined to render summary judgment in favor of the defendants, which precipitated what was eventually a settlement. And we'll go into more detail on that later. I will just tell you the information is scattered all over, and you'll glean a piece out of this and glean a piece out of that. I'm going to start with an article from Nature, and then we'll kind of build from that. The article, of course, is on the internet, and it is for free. You don't have to subscribe to Nature to get it. And then I'm going to give my own synthesized storyline, and then my own opinion, and then we'll kind of throw it open for discussion. The paper in Nature is entitled "University Sued After Firing Creationist Fossil Hunter." Subtitled, "Microscopist's Wrongful Dismissal Case Faces Long Odds." It's written by Christopher Kemp in November of 2014. Keep that in mind as you're reading this. In May 2012, Mark Armitage made a discovery that he had dreamed of for years. While digging in Montana, he uncovered one of the largest Triceratops horns ever found in the Hell Creek Formation, a legendary stack of fossil-bearing rocks that date to the last days of the dinosaurs. Armitage drove the horn back home to Los Angeles, California, where his microscopic examination revealed that it contained not only fossilized bone, but also preserved layers of soft tissue. They were brown, stretchy sheets. "I was shocked to see anything that was that pliable," he says. In February 2013, he published his findings in Acta Histochemica, a journal of cell and tissue research. And they have a link to the article, of course, which we'll look at a little later. 2 weeks later, he was fired from his job at California State University Northridge, CSUN, where he managed the biology department's electron and confocal microscopy suit. Confocal is, bifocal. Now he is embroiled in a long-shot legal fight to get his job back. In July, his lawyers filed a wrongful termination suit claiming that religious intolerance motivated the dismissal. As a young Earth creationist, Armitage says that finding soft tissue in the fossil supports his belief that such specimens date to the time of the biblical flood, which he puts at about 4,000 years ago. The suit alleges that faculty members hostile to Armitage had him fired because they could not stand working with a creationist who had been published in a legitimate scientific journal. He and his attorneys at the Pacific Justice Institute, a conservative legal organization based in Sacramento, California, that focuses on religious and family issues, by the way, just for your interest's sake, it's the lead attorney was a Seventh-day Adventist. Still is a Seventh-day Adventist. that have repeatedly made that claim in the press. But specialists in U.S. labor law, you can tell this is Nature and therefore British, suggest that his claim of religious intolerance might have difficulty standing up if the case goes to trial. In recent years, a school teacher, academic, and NASA employee who were creationists have claimed that they were fired unjustly for their religious beliefs. None were reinstated. But what makes this case different is that Armitage managed to survive for years in a mainstream academic institution and to publish research in a respected peer-reviewed journal. So he's not just a flunky, he actually knows what he's doing. Armitage acknowledges that he did that by keeping his views on the age of the fossil out of the paper. He didn't say it was short age. In fact, we're going to look at the only place where he mentions that at all. Written with biologist Kevin Lee Anderson of Arkansas State University, Beebe, the study simply reported that the horn was found in Hell Creek, which has a well-accepted age of 65 to 70 million years. It was just morphology, says Mary Schweitzer, a paleontologist at North Carolina State University at Raleigh. Most of you have heard of her name, I'm sure, who reviewed the work before publication. So she was one of the peer reviewers and made the first discovery of soft tissue and dinosaur bone in 2005. It was fine. So she passed the paper. Creationists often appeal to soft tissue preservation as evidence that dinosaur fossils are thousands rather than millions of years old, says paleontologist Jack Horner of the Museum of the Rockies in Bozeman, Montana. Who is the model, by the way, for the hero of Jurassic Park. Science is about building hypotheses and then attempting to falsify them, he says. Creation science or any kind of pseudoscience is just the opposite. It is coming up with an idea or a notion or anything else and finding evidence to support it, which raises interesting questions as to whether delivering geology from Moses is a preconceived idea and whether that, therefore, Lyell published pseudoscience, but we will let that pass. According to his lawsuit, Armitage never tried to conceal his beliefs from his employer. The filing says that when he was interviewed for his job at CSUN in November 2009, he did not hide that he holds degrees from the Christian Fundamentalist Liberty University in Lynchburg, Virginia, and the Institute for Creation Research, previously in San Diego, California. And by the way, he not just got degrees from them, he actually worked for them too. In an interview with Nature, Armitage said that he was also equally open about his roughly 30 technical articles on microscopy and his 2008 self-published book, Jesus is Like My Scanning Electron Microscope. The lawsuit also claims that Armitage excelled in his job, receiving numerous letters of commendation. I'm not a microscopist, but as far as I could tell, Armitage was a good one, Paul Wilson, a biologist at CSUN, told Nature. So nobody's really disputing that he's doing his job well, as far as I can tell. At least in general. CSUN declined to comment on Armitage's performance or its reasons for ending his employment. However, Jeffrey Noblet, Associate Vice President of Marketing and Communications at CSUN, did stress in an email that Armitage's position had been temporary. Armitage freely admits that he often engaged students in conversations, giving his opinion on issues such as the age of the remarkably well-preserved cells in the Triceratops horn. To me, the obvious conclusion is they're young. They can't be 68 million years old, he says. In terms of getting his job back, those conversations might be Armitage's undoing. U.S. anti-discrimination laws require employees to reasonably accommodate an employee's beliefs or religious practices unless doing so would cause, quote, undue hardship, end quote, to the employer, says Justine Lesser, a spokesperson for the U.S. Equal Opportunity Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. If Armitage made his living bending metal in a machine shop, an employer would find it difficult to show how his views caused undue hardship, she says. But in an academic setting, telling biology or paleontology students that life began only a few thousand years ago more clearly undermines, get this, the institution's goals. Did you know that creationism undermines the goals of academia? Think about that. It would be an easier showing of undue hardship, says Lisser, because it's more related to the essence of what the person is doing. Apparently what the university is doing as well. Anyway, and there's the reference, Nature. Now, I'm going to give you my kind of synthesis, and I'm going to point out some things. Unfortunately, I have not been able to contact Mark Armitage, and so I cannot tell you exactly how old he is, but I can tell you he is over 49 years old because of various things that you can glean from the literature. He grew up Catholic, but apparently gave up on religion at age 16. A few years later, and it's not clear exactly how many, he had a conversion experience, and then a little bit after that, he tried first to integrate his religious views with kind of a long age, sort of a theistic evolution or evolutionary creation or something, and finally quit that when he ran into something in 1984. And if you do the math, you can tell that he's at least 50. I don't know how much over 50, but that becomes important later on. He had his own microscope sales and service company starting in 1984, about the time that he changed his belief to short-age creationism. He is a lifetime member of the Creation Research Society for a long time here, and a board member more recently. He has worked at the Institute for Creation Research. In 2008, he published a book, which we've mentioned before, Jesus is Like My Scanning Electron Microscope, and subtitled, A Scientist Looks at His Relationship with the Creator. In 2009, he applied for, and by 2010 was given, it looks like there was a couple-month period before he was actually hired, but he was, he certainly, in 2010, he was a part of the CSUN faculty, part-time, about 20 hours a week. He did not want to be full-time because he had his own business on the side, and that would require giving up his business. That becomes important later on. He claims that his immediate colleagues and students were largely unaware of his beliefs through 2012. Just, you know, everybody's kind of getting along, and some things were being said, I guess, you know, kind of under the table, but nobody was really particularly, and he's probably very careful about how he did that. Even asking him to teach a full graduate course in microscopic imaging. He knew his business. His microscopy of a triceratops horn showing soft tissue was reportedly featured in American Laboratory. They say it was featured when I went to American Laboratory. I can't find it, although it may be one of the pictures on the front or something. But American Laboratory doesn't give enough details, so I was able to hunt that down. It's a trade journal anyway. He was featured in a school newsletter, the same stuff about the triceratops horn. So, you know, everybody's kind of, oh, that's interesting stuff. And then it was published in Actohistochemica. We'll get to that paper. And we're going to go, well, actually, we're going to go into that paper right now. This is the abstract. There's two slides on it. Soft fibrillar bone tissues were obtained from a superorbital horn, technical, above the eye, of Triceratops horridus, interesting name, collected at the Hell Creek Formation in Montana, USA. Soft material was present in pre- and post-decalcified bone. There was soft tissue even before they decalcified the bone. Horn material yielded numerous small sheets of lamellar bone matrix. This matrix possessed visible microstructures consistent with lamellar bone osteocytes. Some sheets of soft tissue had multiple layers of intact tissues with osteocyte-like structures featuring filopodal-like interconnections and secondary branching. Notice that all the likes there. He's being very cautious and he's saying it looks like it. He's not saying it is. Actually, he and his co-author. Both oblate and stellate types of osteocyte-like cells were present in sheets of soft tissue and exhibited organelle-like microstructures, nuclei, etc. SEM analysis yielded osteocyte-like cells featuring filopodal extensions of 18 to 20 micrometers in length. Filopodal extensions were delicate and showed no evidence of any permineralization or crystallization artifact, and therefore were interpreted to be soft. This is the first report of sheets of soft tissue from Triceratops horn bearing layers of osteocytes and extends the range and types of dinosaur specimens known to contain non-fossilized material in bone matrix. Interesting. Looks pretty good. Nothing really controversial except that, you know, you saw the soft tissues in a dinosaur, you don't kind of don't expect that. But as he starts out with the introduction, he says, previous studies have reported soft tissues and cell-like microstructures in fossilized dinosaur bones from Tarbosaurus batar, Tyrannosaurus rex, Brachiolophosaurus canadensis, and Triceratops hordes. And the listing is interesting. Palicki, 1978. This has actually been known for a long time, but people just kind of ignored it. Palicki and Zagorska, for what it's worth, it's a German journal. So maybe that's why they've been ignoring it, because nobody reads German journals anymore. Anyway, then of course, Schweitzer and Horner, 1999, and of course there's a whole list of Schweitzer et al. Articles, which some of which we'll see later on. Armitage, 2001. What's that? Well, it turns out that that is a reference to a Creation Research Society quarterly article. Apparently, you can cite those in the peer-reviewed literature if you pick the right subject. Maybe it is peer-reviewed after all. Anyway, Zellerberg and Lauren, 2011, as well as other extinct organisms such as certain marine turtles. And interestingly enough, they don't include the mosasaur that's got published a number of times in PLOS and also had carbon-14 data in it and so forth. So, and you can see the last one is Cadena and Schweitzer, which is, of course, Mary Schweitzer. So, you know, this is actually not a terribly big surprise. Medium, but, you know. Light and electron microscopic studies, when you see the dot, we're continuing the same paragraph, have tentatively identified tissue components of dinosaur remains as red blood cells, endothelial cells, osteocytes, and collagen fibers. And now here's a whole bunch of Schweitzer et al., 2005, 2007A, 2009. Of course, there's a 2007B, so, you know, she's really got publications on this. Isolation of dinosaur peptides and proteins has also helped to confirm the cellular nature of these fine structures. And here again, Schweitzer, Lindgren, who are apparently working on the same kinds of things with Schweitzer, but is a completely different group from a completely different university, and San Antonio et al. In 2011. So by now, it's starting to be kind of accepted. Exceptions to these findings have been offered by Kay et al. In 2008. We'll see a little more of Kay's argument. However, recent analyses seem to confirm that original soft tissues and possibly original molecules do exist in incompletely fossilized remains of extinct animals, including dinosaurs. And again, there's a bunch of references, a good share of which are to Schweitzer. I'm not going to read the whole thing, of course. I'm just going to whiz through and give you the most important parts of it. If you want to read more, the references given. The aim of this paper was to examine fresh fossil specimens of adult supraorbital horn and rib remains of T. horridus for the presence of soft tissues and to characterize any soft tissue found. Okay, and materials and methods, and an intact Triceratops horn was recovered on May 12, 2012 from a well-sorted fluvial sandstone within Hell Creek Formation at a previously unexcavated site on a private ranch within the Hell Creek Formation. And then there's the precise location of the land in Glendive, Montana, for what it's worth. And then hand-sized pieces of HTH-00 were fixed in 2.5% glutaraldehyde solution, which some of you who work in medical note that that's what's used to kill all germs on scopes. colonoscopes, etc. Other horn specimens were processed through a decalcification protocol, which we'll skip over exactly. Decalcified bone was air dried, affixed to aluminum stubs, sputter coated with gold for 60 seconds at 20 milliamps, and imaged, bunch of details that the people who actually do this want to know, but most of you probably don't. Triceratops rib specimens were allowed to air dry and were subsequently fractured and then looked at. And the results, I'm not going to read you the results in description. I'm just going to let you kind of look at some of the pictures that they've got. This tape measure, by the way, right there is 2 feet from the end. So this is about a 3 foot, like that, That's decent horn. Here is one of the ribs that they looked at. There's a fraction of the horn that was, broken off and then sent to put glutaraldehyde or whatever on it. And it's interesting that when they went to look at it, you see these little arrow things? These are actually roots of modern-day plants, as far as I can tell, rootlets. And so if you're wondering, should we do a carbon-14 date on it, don't bother. It's going to be claimed to be contaminated, if not contaminated. So it's not going to really help you much. Whereas some of the other ones that don't have rootlets might be more impressive in that way. And here are these little things that kind of look like bugs. That one you could swear was a beetle. But if you're a histologist, and I actually took histology once upon a time and saw those things, they look like human osteocytes. They just do. There's some more. I think this one is from the rib, but they found them in both places. Here's a scanning electron microscope of a Haversian canal, and there's cred in here, and then there's looks like a pretty standard Haversian canal if you've done in histology. This is one from the rib, I know. Here's some of what look like blood vessels. And here's another blood vessel in that arrow there. They're going to enlarge that area. And interestingly enough, in contrast to Schweitzer, instead of little round red structures, he has crystals in there. So there's been some diagenesis in this particular specimen. But, here is a couple of the cells that, look like osteocytes. I should say cell-like structures to be very careful. Here's some more. If you look at scanning electron microscopes of human or ostrich or whatever, they look like osteocytes. Those little structures apparently help to keep the bone metabolically in decent shape. It allows the small cell to control a large area of bone. Now, his discussion, again, I'm going to skip over some parts that will probably not be that interesting to you, some of which we've covered. Kay et al. In 2008, you remember we were going to come back to him, maintains that the soft tissue from dinosaur fossils is polysaccharide from a microbial biofilm. They propose that the polysaccharide film forms a cast of the tissue. Once dissolved from the fossilized bone matrix, this film purportedly retains the shape of vessels and osteocytes. They conclude that what has been described as intact tissue is actually biofilm polysaccharide. Furthermore, Rasmussen et al. Report that some of the microorganisms can form collagen-like proteins, which Kay et al. Suggests might be mistaken for dinosaur collagen. Of course, there's a question of how much, and if the polysaccharide film is more than 50% collagen, it does raise some interesting questions. But what is not made clear by Kay et al. Is the mechanism by which microbes might replicate stellate and oblate osteocytes in such well-preserved and fine detail. Why does it look so good? including internal nucleus-like spheres, primary and secondary filipodia, and cell-to-cell junctions as reported here. What is also not clear is how such biofilm structures could themselves survive the ravages of time, as once produced, other microorganisms could begin to digest even those. In other words, why do you make this stuff out of polysaccharide and then not have more bacteria come in and mess the whole thing up? The most parsimonious explanation is that these are original tissues. And I guess I agree with him, and I Schweitzer must agree with him too, because she passed this thing. The fact that any soft tissues were present in this heavily fossilized horn specimen would suggest a selective fossilization process or a sequestration of certain deep tissues as a result of the deep mineralization of the outer dinosaur bones as described by Schweitzer et al. So maybe that's what happened. However, as described previously, however, the horn was not desiccated when recovered and actually had a muddy matrix deeply embedded within it. So this stuff didn't sit in something dry. It actually had mud around it and penetrating into it. It does not seem reasonable to suggest that the original tissues would not survive through deep time, but replicated structures captured in biofilms would. And that comment about deep time is the only comment about time in the article. Skipping on, the most straightforward interpretation, this is the last sentence of the article, is that intact cells and tissues have been preserved in this Triceratops fossil. Okay, now I'm going to give you a little more primary information, although this is Mark's claim and not undisputed fact. The facts are these. He's obviously intending to give what he claims is his version of the facts. I don't personally have any reason to dispute any of this. Ernie Kwok came into my lab in June of 2012. Now notice this is actually before the paper was published. And said, "We will not tolerate your religionism in this department or your creationist projects either." Later in 2012, when Kwok assumed the chairmanship of the Electron Microscope Committee, which supervised my lab, he made it plain he was my supervisor, and he met with the committee on the day my paper was published online and told the secretary, "Don't tell Mark," that they were meeting in secret on a committee that I had served for 38 months. I was excluded from the meeting. It was, that should be a dot, this is actually part of the same paragraph. It was in that meeting that they determined to fire me. 10 days later, I was terminated. Quote, "because the lab has to be shut down due to funding issues," end quote. I don't know when that excuse came. There's some indication that at first they were totally mum and then they came up with this excuse later, but unfortunately I don't have a good timeline on that I can prove. The lab is still up and running today. This is in 2014, I believe. Don't believe me? Just go to CSUN Biology and look up the microscopy lab. In fact, the lab phone number still answers with my voice. Guy was fired, but they didn't change the voicemail introduction. According to his attorney, and I confirmed that with Reinach, Armitage was in fact fired. He was not released. He was not laid off. He was just fired, period, with apparently no reason given initially. It was later claimed that the school was trying to save money and close down the lab, eliminating his position. Reinach said that evidence against the campus officials was seen in an email suggesting that Armitage could be eased out of a job by making his position full-time. And this actually got into one of the other reports as well, which of course is horribly damaging because, see, what they were going to do is they were going to make it full-time instead of part-time, and he only wanted a part-time job, so he would kind of say, "Well, why don't you look for somebody else to do it full-time, because I really don't want the job full-time." That was the theory. or at least that was the suggestion that was being made. And of course, that completely gives the lie to the idea that, oh, there's tight budget constraints and we just didn't have enough money. Not only did it support the notion that there, not only did it not support the notion that there was budgetary concerns, but in fact suggested to the contrary. The judge threw out two charges and punitive damages, but kept two charges. And the two charges that were kept was FEHA religious discrimination. For those of you who don't know, that's the California Fair Employment and Housing Act, which since I work for the state in one of my jobs, every 2 years I have to endure a review of this thing because they want everybody to know what the law is so that if we violate the law, we can't use the defense, but I didn't know. And number two is failure to prevent or investigate a violation of FEHA. So, you know, first there was a discrimination and then there was the failure to fix that, which of course goes to the supervisors. The case was settled out of court for something between $400,000 to $1 million, as far as I can tell. Now, some of that depends on how you count it. Yes, I'm going to pass the mic down.
I just wanted to ask, so you had mentioned earlier that you weren't able to speak to Armitage himself, but only his attorney. Is that because the settlement included some kind of like a gag order, possibly?
That is debatable. There apparently are some things they're not allowed to talk about, but apparently there are some things that are. And Armitage is preparing a book on this eventually. So I assume that the gag order can't be too tight. No, there's a claim that it was $399,000 and something dollars or something like that. Why I say it depends on how you count it, do you count what Armitage got or do you count what Armitage got plus his attorney's fees plus the cost of the suit to the you know, because the defendants had attorney's fees as well and probably wound up paying court costs. So, you know, those numbers are a little shaky. There are people who claim that the $400,000 was everything that he and his attorneys got. I get the feeling from what I have been looking at that that is probably what he got personally. But in any case, the $400,000 is 15 times the salary of Mark Armitage. Now remember, Mark Armitage is at least 50 years old. That means that that would pay him until he was 65. Think about it. This is from CrevInfo. I just flat out stole it. Indications are that significant haggling went on before State Council apparently stood firm, according to Dr. Jay Wiley, who spoke with Mark and wrote about it on a blog entry. Mark tells CEH that all parties signed, checks were written, and my oh my, some of them were very big. Well, to somebody who's, you know, making a certain amount of money, $400,000 does look kind of big. Actually, it looks pretty big to me, but I'll take that. The case was settled and does not set judicial precedent. Nobody can cite this as, you see, these guys should have known you can't fire people for these kind of offenses. However, and CSUN still insists officially that Armitage was let go for budgetary reasons. They're sticking to their story, and because it's settled, nobody can really dispute that legally. Well, you can dispute it, but you can't prove they're wrong. And nevertheless, CSUN would not have agreed to such a large settlement if they thought they could win in court. Again, I'm quoting Crev.info. Reineck believes. They certainly would not have paid that kind of money if they did not recognize that we had them dead to rights. And in talking to Reinach personally, he made that comment. Now, what do I think of all this? I think the article was significant, but not breaking major new ground. That's already been done by Schweitzer, and even before that, by the German researchers. The stimulus for firing was clearly not the religious beliefs of Armitage. He was hired, and they knew what they were getting when they hired him. Nor was it the article per se, because the information had already gotten out and everybody was kind of happy about it. It appears to be the combination of the elevation of Kwok and the fact that Armitage was now able to spread his beliefs without even explicitly arguing for them. That he could do the Socratic, you know, hey, I got a neat article published. Let me look. Triceratops horn has that in it? And Armitage just innocently says, what do you think it means? And he doesn't say a word. And the student goes, maybe it's not that old. I think one needs to be very careful what one puts in an email. As I think we have seen through recent history, emails can be deadly. The best policy may be simply to be aware that religious discrimination is illegal, just like they pound into our heads that sexual discrimination is illegal, and avoid engaging in it. Of course, that may make it hard to keep creationists out of academia, but maybe in California that's how you have to go. It also helps to be honest. You know, when you say that you're going to fire somebody for one reason and you have documented evidence that it's another reason instead, that doesn't look too good in front of a jury. And the final thing I think we can say safely is that creationists have a leg to stand on if they're unjustly fired. Now, this can go in all kinds of different directions, and now I'm going to give you a chance to go in your direction. Ariel.
This is an ongoing battle, of course, one in which you find all kinds of opinions. The Supreme Court 3 times has stated that you cannot teach religion in the public school classrooms.
As science
per se, and so and this has prevailed quite a bit, and I am very pleased that we got a little beyond that in this case, that even though there might have been some religion involved, they still had to pay the money, not because of the religion, but because of other factors, probably. I don't know what the real argument was.
Well, actually, here's what happened, and it's very interesting. You see, they've been trying to exclude it by putting it into religion. What they didn't realize is that in the back end, there is this protected group class. And it has race, it has sex, it has, now in California, it has sexual orientation, it has all kinds of things that are, you know, politically popular. It also has religion. And from a kind of one aspect, that's wonderful because Muslims can't be persecuted for their religious orientation.
But Christians can.
But, well, here's the thing. As it turns out, Christians can't, if you are sharp enough to pick up what's going on. And you see, if the entire place has Darwin fishes all over it, those are anti-religious symbols. And And then you say, we won't tolerate your religion in here. Well, you know, what would happen if somebody had come in and said, we won't tolerate your race in here. Or, we won't tolerate your sex in here. This is a men-only department. You know, it won't fly. And so, as long as you can show that you're not actually damaging the department, you're protected. Period. And so what's happened is that when they pushed it out to religion, they didn't realize that they're trying to stomp on it because it's not science, and now they're trying to stomp on it because it's not the accepted religion. Well, sooner or later you run into those laws, and so it's finally gotten backed into a corner and come back out at them. And it doesn't mean that everybody's going to find it easy to get hired because they're creationist, but it does mean that if you're going to not hire somebody because they're creationist, or you're going to fire them because they're creationist, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to do it sotto voce, you know, sort of like Texaco did with blacks a few years ago and got nailed, and they just said them, and they never said exactly who they were, but everybody knew. And when they could prove that this is what was going on in Texaco, Texaco had to settle the suit. Well, you know, academia is now getting hit by the same arguments in reverse that they have been, that the liberals have been using against corporate America for a long time.
Let me pursue this just from a slightly different angle. Remember in the 1970s when Leonard Brand and I went up to Sacramento and testified in front of the Education Committee, some creationists, Dr. Ford, were trying to insert a creation clause into the California science curriculum. This is a public school curriculum. And we argued that where is your academic freedom if you don't allow creation to be discussed? In fact, I got on CBS National News that evening for having made that statement.
That was back when CBS meant something.
Yes. It might have been ABC. It was one of those main networks. to me, the basic issue, Supreme Court, when it says you can't teach religion as science, per se, is curtailing information. This is not academic freedom. When you try and say, well, we don't look at these views, basically, truth has to trump other factors if you're going to find truth.
And that Pardon is, the expression.
I think if you make honest inquiry and truth the goal, these are the arguments all tend to fall by the side.
Well, what's happened is that people were trying to put creationism in a gray area that was neither religion nor science, and that wasn't protected by religious freedom, but yet was not science and therefore couldn't be in the scientific curriculum. And what happened was that they worked too hard in the science and they got pushed into religion, and now it's protected.
You can't compartmentalize truth.
Yeah, well, you can push it out of your little field, but if you do, it's still there. It just means that your field can't encompass that particular area, that's all. Yeah, Leonard Brand. Since your name has been taken in vain.
Yeah, I should have contacted you, but Mark Armitage was here on campus a few weeks ago. He helped us solve a problem with a microscope.
Oh.
He knows what he's doing. A few years ago, he also inquired about working on a PhD here, but he would have had to have been full-time, and that wasn't going to work with his job, so he didn't do it.
Yeah. So the threat to make this a full-time position was actually would have been a good way to move him out. And the fact of the matter is that they didn't choose to make that their official story, but the fact that it was floated as an unofficial story, or as a possibility for a story, kind of gives the lie to the idea that they were really tight on money. And, of course, that's the kind of thing that a smart lawyer will bring up in front. Well, professor, were you really intending to get rid of the department? Well, professor, is the department still running? Well, professor, did you make an offer to make this position full-time? Does that mean that you have money to do it full-time? You know, and you can just see the jury listening to this and going, yeah, right. So, yeah, it's a very interesting situation.
Where is he now?
Mark Armitage? I think he still has his company. And I think that... Well, now he's surviving off of his salary without having to work for it, so he's sitting pretty right now.
I
think he's actually in, he has a place in Arizona right now that's under the auspices of the Creation Research Society. I could be wrong on that. I'm reading between the lines on that.
It's right near Prescott.
Which is just across the border from California. A question here and then one over here. Yes.
If he's independently wealthy, does he now have the time to do a PhD in Loma Linda? whereas because it was settled out of court, it can't be used as a precedent legally, I think practically it could be a precedent. If institutions know what happened, then they're going to be disinclined to discriminate on the basis of religion in circumstances close to this.
Well, I think they will be less inclined, let's put it that way.
Yeah.
And I think that they will be more careful about what they say, and especially more careful about what they email. I found out an interesting bit of information. Apparently, you know, one of the things they do when they have these kinds of suits is get discovery, and that means the other side has to give you all their documents. And so the other side did give all the documents that... had to do with Mark Armitage, and it was like, I don't know, 15,000 pages or something like that. It was like, are we really going to do this? And the attorney said that he looked at it and he said, I can't get all through all this stuff. But what they failed to realize is that Mark Armitage is a researcher. And so Mark went through it and read all of those pages and pulled out, you know, after 5,000 pages, you know, here's one that looks interesting, and here's one that looks interesting. And he took it to the attorney, and they do look interesting. We'll have to use these. And so apparently that's why once summary judgment was refused, it was like a couple of weeks and they settled. And in fact, they started out by, apparently, there was a lot of shouting at the first meeting. And they weren't going to settle. And then, Rynex says, fine, we'll see you in court. And they went home and thought about it a little bit, and, you know, he's right. And apparently one other thing that happened, too, and this is kind of inside information, but apparently the judge went to them and said, do you know what you're doing? You realize that half the people in the United States are creationists. You realize that you're going to get a jury out of that bunch. And it suddenly dawned on them that this was not going to be a jury of academics judging them. And, you know, I don't know for sure, but I kind of think that may have had a little something to do with the fact that they said, okay, we'll just pay you until you retire.
Is it really appropriate for a judge to be advising one side?
Talk to the judge. Actually, there is, before trial happens, there is a mandatory settlement conference. And that's when they were arguing, we're right, and the other guys are wrong, and so forth. So I think the judge, you know, kind of said, do you know what you're doing? And it suddenly dawned on them that that this was going to be a level playing field at best for them. And, you know, at this point, they can't lean on authority because it's been taken away from them. And the smarter people said, you know, you better get rid of this one. Because they had him, you know, with contradictory statements and with, you know, there's some other things where that were dug up as background. The dean who was presiding over all this had already been hit by religious discrimination action and lost. And so now this is part of a pattern, you know. And so there's a lot that's going on beneath the surface that you wouldn't know about.
Would it
be
helpful if this story, if other institutions were to learn about this story? In other words, could there be a preventive measure done to help other institutions not discriminate on the basis of religion in this respect?
Do you remember that Inside Higher Education thing? Mm. This is news. How many people choose to look at it, I don't know, but I think that there are a lot of people who have looked at it and who are realizing, you know, we better be really careful about this. Now, the next phase, I think, will be, well, we won't hire these people. And that will work until two people arrive, one with clearly better credentials otherwise and one with clearly less credentials otherwise, and they hire the less credentialed person because they're an evolutionist. And about that time, there'll be another email dump that will make people cautious about even that kind of discrimination. Now, will it go away? No. Discrimination is with us, and the kind that's totally unstated, you're going to be stuck with, because nobody's going to fix the system perfectly. But I think that the more egregious parts of it will not be sustainable in the near future.
What is biofilm? And was that a pivotal thing? What is that?
For the lawsuit, it's not a pivotal thing. Because, you know, the guy published, it's in there. But for the argument about whether these things are really old osteocytes or whether they're just somehow preserved remnants, it is an argument. And the argument is bacteria will put out polysaccharides and leave this kind of film.
Oh, okay.
And the theory is, you see, that they grew along the osteocyte without ever eating it up, or maybe with eating it up, but while they were eating up, they were laying down biofilm that looked just like an osteocyte.
Okay.
Now, there are a few problems with that theory. One of them is that biofilms are traditionally polysaccharides, which means they have a bunch of sugars hooked together, and sugar, amino sugars and a few things like that. I mean, I'm using the term sugars loosely because it's not just like table sugar or glucose or fructose. There's other things that are hooked in there too. But it's definitely not protein. It's not made out of amino acids. It's totally different stuff. And it's easy enough to find out, well, what is that film really protein or is it really sugar? Now, to be fair, some proteins will have a little bit of sugar hooked to them. But if you've got something that's like 95% protein, I'm sorry, it's not biofilm. Whereas, if you have stuff that's 80% sugar, it probably is biofilm, and it's definitely not osteocyte wall. So this is a testable difference between two theories. Have they looked at that? Well, that depends on how you define look. Sorry to get Clintonian on you, but... here's what happens, okay? The one side is saying, look at this neat stuff, it's still left over from the dinosaurs. And Schweitzer, even though she believes in 68 million years, says that, along with her colleagues, okay? There's another side that says, that can't last this long. There's no way that that's original material. And so it's got to be something else. Well, what could it be? Well, maybe biofilm. You see, and for that claim, you only have to look far enough to make your claim plausible. You don't actually have to prove it because the intention is not to prove the claim. The intention is to leave space for your worldview to survive. Okay? Of course, Schweitzer and Armitage, this is one area where Schweitzer and creationists are kind of on the same side, will go and say, well, okay, so what if it was biofilm? What would you expect to find? And so they will do mass spectrometry of these kinds of things and see, well, what kind of molecular weights do we get out of it? Are they kind of the molecular weights that you expect from sugars and amino sugars? Or are they more like the molecular weights you expect from proteins and polypeptides and amino acids? And as far as I know, there isn't a lot of argumentation on that because this is a relatively new field, but the argumentation that is there is largely in favor of this not being biofilm, this being protein and therefore original stuff. But, you know, and that's why they say, well, maybe the bacteria produce protein sort of like collagen. You can see how if you really need to have the evidence come your way, that's what you're going to do. And you will do it just far enough to leave room for you. You won't try to really do a good test because the good test might come out the wrong way, and then you'd have to publish that, and then you'd really be in trouble. Yes?
That's a new reality that... That the people who are on the other side have to contend with pretty soon, in that you mentioned Islam. They believe in 6-day creation. What if some of these folk become researchers, many of them are physicians, and they have their name in one of the articles? Then it's no longer Christians and non-Christians.
Yes, and here's this article by Muhammad Rashad.
There you are. Yes. And all hell break loose. You see, the thing is, these folk are, the money, the $400,000 or $1 million, does not come from their individual pockets. It's coming from you and me, the taxpayers.
That's right. It comes from the CSUN budget.
Yeah. Look at, what if there's a $1 billion lawsuit? Can it happen if you can put one of the names there?
Well, especially if you have like a whole group that kind of disappears like this.
Yes. And it's coming. It's not too far.
Anyway, a comment, but first a comment back here.
Earlier there was a comment, you can't compartmentalize truth. And I think probably that was meant in maybe a slightly different way than what I'm going to talk about. But I think you can, and it's necessary. For example, the scientific process is based on studying natural laws, if I'm not mistaken. And the idea is that it's necessary to have things that are testable, results that can be falsifiable, that kind of thing. So if we believe in a creation that's a supernatural occurrence that's sort of outside the realm of what the scientific process can discover. It's outside the realm of a scientific truth, which doesn't mean that it's something that's irrelevant. It just means that when people are doing research that supports a creationist point of view, for example, when my father does research, he focuses on things that are within the realm of scientific processes, scientific truth, that kind of thing, which is why for people who are not, who don't let personal religious or anti-religious beliefs affect them, why a lot of his peers in the scientific community who don't share his beliefs will still accept the paper and print it in journals and things like that. So it seems like that can be one of the things that can both help Christian scientists get published more widely and also help schools like CSU, Northridge, avoid these kinds of lawsuits by distinguishing between religious comments or religious truths and scientific truths. And it seems like one of the big problems here was that he published a paper that clearly non-Christian scientists didn't have a problem with and felt like was good, was a very good...
I'd be careful with that phrasing of it because Mary Schweitzer is technically a Christian.
Oh, is she? I don't know who she is.
She's a long-age Christian.
Okay.
But she's a Christian.
But
so,
just that
scientists could look at it and say, yeah, you know, all that stuff, he did it, and he did it right, and the results he's publishing are correct as far as we can tell, and, you know, let's put it in the literature and let people look at it. Yeah.
So, yeah, it seems like that distinguishing between kinds of truths, and which is not to say that Christian scientists should give up on at all talking about those kinds of things, but it seems like you said, if you're just talking about evidence, if you're talking about things that happen within the scientific process, people can figure out implications that go beyond truths that are solely within the realm of scientific truth.
Yeah. Well, I think the philosophical question comes like this. Is there an inside and an outside to science? And the instinctive reaction is, yes, there is. It's a very difficult philosophical line to make. And I think the reason why is because there are things inside of science that point outside of science as to their most likely answer. Now, are those things in science, or because they point outside of science, are they outside of science? And so until you make some kind of an arbitrary cut there, there isn't a complete separation. And that's why the philosophers of science have just torn their hair out trying to figure out criteria that will reliably establish what's inside of science and what's outside of science. We all kind of know that there is this inside, but unless you want to go the Stephen Jay Gould route with non-overlapping magisteria, they are totally separate from each other, then there will be points of contact, and do those points of contact belong in science, or do they belong in something else? Or do they belong in both? And it's almost a matter of how you define it. And no definition is going to be completely comfortable with a nice, clean wall. The only way that could happen is by the noma, the non-overlapping magisteria. And so if Stephen Jay Gould is wrong, then this problem won't have an answer until we recognize that while there may be a large separation, there are holes in between.
Yeah. This is a difficult area to find a clean solution. And because we're not dealing with just objective evaluation of truth, we are dealing with certain prejudices, I might say, or certain opinions and so on that shade the whole area and that prevent the process of finding truth, of operating openly. It's we want our scientists and advanced institutions to be respected by the scientific community. We want them to advocate creation, and we want the them to get grants from the granting agencies outside and so on. And you're dealing with a very prejudiced scientific community. You're asking them to perform that way. They're in a very difficult position. You're because of this prejudice that exists out there. But I feel there is no scientist can tell you how life originated all by itself. As soon as you pose that question, their case that they have a complete system falls apart. And the door is open for other ideas, and I think that look at the whole picture here, and you're going to have an open mind on that.
Yeah, and once you agree that the origin of life had a creator that stepped into the universe once it was already made, then it becomes harder to slam the door on the Cambrian explosion, for example. It becomes harder to insist that the that the mammalian explosion, that the avian explosion, that the turtle explosion,
and that paraconformities are flat.
Well, and then once you concede that God's been intervening all along, then it becomes harder to say, well, he couldn't have done it that fast, without dealing with some very difficult questions, and one of them is. Why, after 68 million years, are there still osteocytes in Triceratops' horns? Yeah. And Mark Armitage can look at his students and say, no, this isn't something I read in the literature. This is something we did in a microscope. And I can do it again if you want. It's all over. And in fact, the truth of the matter is that for the people who have looked at bones, it looks like there's a perhaps significant minority, perhaps a majority, of these bones that actually have original material in them. And that we're going to find out that everybody just assumed it couldn't be and said it all replaced with minerals and that's what a fossil is. And as it turns out, it isn't.
I just might add a little sidelight here. We've discussed a little bit about court cases and question of could a student who is superior be denied admission because he was not a minority group? And I might point out the Supreme Court has ruled that a university can do this under the banner of diversity. And to extend that, I would say, well, let's have a little diversity in science here and include creation also. If you're going to promote diversity, if the university wants to promote diversity, let's hear a little bit about creation.
Well, I think that that if viewpoint discrimination ever catches fire and with a conservative bunch controlling the government and liberals, by and large, controlling most universities, you may very well see legislation to that effect. And if you do, and it's upheld by the Supreme Court, which now looks like it's going to be back to conservative again, it may be very interesting to see what happens to American legal education policy.
I'm just here. Reinach, did he defend Armitage?
Reinach, yes, he did.
He did. He's important.
I don't know how they got together. That I didn't. I had only a short time to interview him, so I tried to concentrate on the most important stuff.
You know, he's our Union Conference Religious Liberty man.
I understand that.
Yeah.
I mean, I got the I read the articles and I said, Reinach, I've seen that name before. yes, and was there a comment over here? No, okay.
Some of these
people, these scientists, are going to have to be much more careful about what they put in emails and online discussions of things. Because for a few years, I was on an online discussion group of vertebrate paleontologists, and they were just very bold statements made there. If one of your students is a creationist, you should not give them recommendations to medical school. Just don't do it, because
that's how the published letter, well, not the published, the email, an email, the cyberspace out, the internet now, mm-hmm. clearly. Some guy in Texas, I think, who was refusing to do that. So, yeah, it's that's out there. It's mm-hmm. not just in the discussions.
Right. It's in there.
And if they do that, they're treading on thin ice, because I think if that happens, it's just going to be, if that goes to conservative Supreme Court, it's going to blow up in their faces, I think.
We have a lot of cases in past history among creationists of discrimination. You can look at Robert Gentry, Oak Ridge Laboratory. He never was granted a full-time position, I understand, and he had to have funding from Columbia Union College and other sources.
But beyond that, once he testified at trial, they cut off his access to the lab,
period.
That was
the beginning of the end for him, I understand, although I wasn't involved in any of that. You have Gonzalez, The Privileged Planet.
And that's not even challenging evolution. That's just challenging the idea that the universe runs without God.
Exactly. You have Gonzalez. You can go way back to Clifford Burdick as a student. He was in a doctoral program in palynology, University of Arizona, back in the 1950s or early 60s. And he was not allowed to continue his dissertation work on pollen because I think maybe I might be wrong. Ariel, you'll remember. I think he had an article in Science of the Times or
yes,
one of the church.
Exactly,
magazines.
Science of the Times.
Was it Science?
And that was his downfall.
It really, literally was his downfall. Well, otherwise, he was onto something. There is pollen in the Precambrian. There is pollen. I don't deny that, and I've studied pollen.
I've told you about, so long ago, you probably don't remember this, a graduate student in Belgrade, Yugoslavia, was finishing up his master's degree in geology, and he got on television a few weeks before he was through and pointed out he was a creationist, and the committee got together right after that. He had a three-man committee at the University of Belgrade, and they excused him because of that. And he was familiar with my book, Origins. But somebody later on took my book, Science Discovers God, and sent it to one of his committee members. I don't know how that committee member got hold of it. That committee member read the book, and he got on the phone, and he called this student, and he apologized to him. He said, "I'm so very sorry for what we did to you. I've read this book about Science Discovers God, and it was wrong. What we did was wrong."
I will have to ask, was the dismissal before or after the revolution in Eastern Europe? In other words, are there political ramifications to this?
Occurred around 96, 97, 98, somewhere.
That would be afterwards.
Afterwards, yeah. Yeah, definitely afterwards.
Now, we have cases of survival as well. Kurt Wise, it's amazing that He made it all the way through the loops at Harvard with Stephen Jay Gould.
As his major professor.
Yeah. Now, that's a success story. But another one, John Baumgartner, working at White Sands there in New Mexico, has had a prominent position. I think he's gone independent now. I don't think he works there anymore.
He's retired.
Oh, that's it. He retired. And I don't know that he ever had a major hassle. They weren't going to drop him because of his religious beliefs. And he published widely in creationist journals, even when he was working there.
Don Rigby and Orville Clark both had to change universities because they were creationists.
Wow.
For what it's worth, as long as you're going that route, you may remember that Steve Austin published under a pseudonym for some time before he actually got his PhD.
Exactly.
And so that was another way that people got around that, is they just kept their heads down as far as they could and then did the little puppet thing until they
I can add a little more about Austin. I visited him when he was a doctoral student at Penn State University, because I was thinking of going on getting a doctorate in paleobotany, and that's his doctorate. So I actually was in his home and talked to him. He introduced me to some of his professors there, and one was a catastrophist, DeKeeley or something like that. He was into meteorite bombardments. And
his explanation of the coal fields was that they were massive flood deposits just 350 million years ago.
The meteorites could hit, giant tsunamis would come along and sweep the coal, the wood into coal beds. This was DeKeeley, a full-time professor. He never really published. He advocated these ideas, you know, one-on-one, and Austin knew about them. So I thought, well, maybe I should study under DeKeeley, but never went that way.
Interestingly, Austin published under a pseudonym.
Yeah.
First, because of the prejudice.
There's somebody else that published under a pseudonym, too, but I don't remember who it was.
John Woodmorap.
Well, Woodmorap does, but he never finished his PhD.
No, he didn't finish.
But there was somebody who actually finished who did that. I want to say Stephen or Andrew Snelling, but I'm not sure. It was one of the, I think it was one of the other rate people.
That could be.
But anyway.
Steve Austin, also one of his professors, who was Traverse was his name there at Penn State, made the comment publicly that had they known that he was a creationist, they never would have passed him.
Marcus Ross got through by basically just keeping his head down.
There clearly is some cases of very outright discrimination. I mean, there's a lot of those, but there's another side to be aware of, and I'm not sure Burdick is a good example of this discrimination. Art Chadwick had a discussion once with the guy who'd been Burdick's professor. And he understood what Burdick was about, but the part of Burdick's problem, he just was difficult and was not very careful. And so it wasn't, that was probably not one of these clear discrimination cases.
Kurt, that's important for, if we're on the other side, I do think we have to do careful work.
Yes.
And I do think that we have to be careful not to overstate, which is one of the failings of creationists in the past, is that they've you know, we now have this stuff and that proves that the whole thing is wrong. Well, science doesn't usually work that way. That's one piece of evidence, and then you have to, you know, look at other evidence. Rather than saying, and here's the evidence on our side and here's the evidence on their side, is better yet is to say, and here's this theory and here's that theory, and where do they differ, and can we go and check something else that will make a difference between the two?
Personality makes a difference.
Yeah.
I know Kurt Weiss well, and I know the story about he and Stephen Gould. It certainly had a lot to do with Kurt Weiss's personality. Yeah. That he could get along. He and Gould became good friends. And Gould finally said, you know, when you go to apply for jobs, I won't tell them you're a creationist. And Marcus Ross, his professor, he knew what he believes. And Kurt, I've talked with Marcus Ross about his professor. His professor is a person who is an atheist and has thought it all through and is comfortable with his position and he's secure enough to not be threatened by somebody who thinks different. And so personality makes a difference. Galileo, I mean, there's a lot of things said about how the church persecuted Galileo. Well, other scientists at that time were questioning geocentrism and were not getting in trouble. A lot of Galileo's problems were his abrasive personality, insulted the Pope, and he just had to answer for his abrasiveness.
You're
personality,
exactly right.
Personality makes a big difference. It can. In the case of like Rigby, I think I know enough about it to think that was clearly prejudice. He was a great guy and was very much appreciated until in one of his major exams, it became evident he was a creationist, and one of his professors swore for a few minutes and left, and that was the end of his program. So there are different sides of this, a different person, so you can't always assume exactly what happened without knowing the situation.
Well, you know, there's a famous quote by a guy that I respect greatly that says that we are to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And I think that's true even if we have the truth and we have the legal right to grind it into their faces. I think we need to be... Well, first of all, one thing to keep in mind is that creationism may be the tip of the spear today, but it's not really the most fundamental value. The most fundamental value is that God loves you. And whenever we display a God who doesn't love you, who now that you've done wrong is just going to push your face into it and make you cry uncle, because that's the way we act, and obviously that's the way our God acts. I think when we do that, we actually do more of a disservice to the Creator than if we were on the wrong side. And so that doesn't mean that if we do everything right, we'll always get through. No. You know, we will have persecution at times. But just there's no reason for us to bring it on ourselves for no good reason. And there's especially no reason for us to bring it on ourselves for no good reason when it slanders the Creator.
Paul?
So I think this is a really important point, is that we do have the obligation to be careful, to be honest, and to be kind, considerate, loving, friendly, all those things.
Just one instance with Kurt Weiss. One time, he was walking across campus and he saw Gould sitting out on the steps outside the building. And he knew immediately something was wrong. Because Gould was a very famous speaker, but one-on-one he was not really comfortable with people. He was not a person who would sit out and talk to students. And so Kurt knew immediately something was wrong. He went over and just sat down beside him and didn't say a thing. Finally, Gould says, "Well, Kurt, you're the first person to learn, and my doctor just told me I've got cancer." And put this in contrast. After that, then, he told his faculty what was happening, and he read them a letter from a person he got from a Christian, and I would put Christian in quotes. The letter said, they berated him for his evolutionism and said, "We're praying that you'll get cancer." And Gould said, "There's one prayer that's been answered." Okay, so there was a contrast between that person and Kurt, and I think that had a lot to say about Kurt's success.
Yeah.
Go ahead, and then we'll come in.
We need to be careful to not put a black coat on all these scientists out there. And I'll just state my own case. Two Adventists had been excused from the University of Michigan in the very department I was in just before I applied there, and I didn't know anything about it. And when my creation issue came up in the oral examination by the committee, which is the one you've got to pass if you're going to be allowed to go on, my major professor told me what happened afterwards. He said, a certain professor, I'll keep the names out of it, wanted to fail you. He says, but another professor said what he believes is his own business. And the chairman said, I agreed with him, it was his own business, and that he can believe what he wants to, but it's what he knows that's important. And they allowed me to pass.
This lawsuit, by the way, will encourage the latter attitude.
Yeah. but later on, the faculty was not happy yet. Hey, what are we going to do with this guy? 32-member faculty of the zoology department. I mean, they're at the University of Michigan. And so they sent the professor of evolution to talk to me. And I talked to him strictly in scientific terms. In about 15 minutes, he said, you're okay. They were concerned, are you a scientist or are you not? I stuck strictly by science. And he said, you're okay.
Didn't you at that point raise the question of how the scapula got from the outside to the inside of the turtle's...
Yes, exactly. I raised a question about the turtle at that time and so on. And
but you didn't come at it like, and no. See, it happened and it couldn't happen any other way, and so you guys are just wrong.
Right. And they told me at the end, the only reason they led me through is because they couldn't decide what to do with me. I thought I'd produce a good dissertation, but they had another idea in mind.
Anyway, Jan, let's give you the microphone and give you the last shot at it. Thank
you. Could Armitage have fought for his position?
Well, apparently he published a paper. It was, so to speak, the last straw. Kwok got everybody together and railroaded him. It looks like the same day. The story I'd heard earlier was it was 2 or 3 days, so I don't know. But in any case, it was very shortly thereafter. He really kind of got blindsided before you could mount a defense at all. So the only legal recourse is to say, hey, you can't do that. And one of the things that happened when they settled is that they didn't have to take him back. And so there was some financial incentive for them to pay him completely off rather than, you see, if it went to a jury trial, not only would he get his back pay, but he would become a basically unfireable person. He would have gotten kind of instant legal tenure.
But he had judge and jury on his side at the time, correct?
Well, that...
When he was paid off.
You can guarantee that. And that's why Reinach told me that's why he settled, because every once in a while you get stupid juries. But let's put it this way. The probability of a stupid jury going one way versus going the other way was much higher. And the other people finally realized that, and that's why they folded, is because they said, look, if we pay him off, he won't be on our faculty. We can say we cut him for budgetary reasons, and they can't claim that legally it was judged that we lied. And so that's better than waiting for a jury to tell us, no, you keep him on your faculty for the rest of your life, and you pay him, you pay him punitive damages. Because the jury would have gone, I mean, juries are that way. They are not figuring out the cold legal, well, let's see, this is worth $300,000, this is worth $200,000. they go, those guys, they have no right to have done that, and we're going to sock them for everything the plaintiff wants. Sometimes they've given more.
Yeah, it reminds me of the Menendez brothers many years ago. They killed their very rich parents in Hollywood, and the jury is crying, says, come to think these kids don't have their parents anymore. So yes, jury could go either way.
It's literally the chutzpah of saying, killing your parents and pleading for mercy under the court because you're an orphan.
Yeah, there you are, because you're an orphan. By the way, could you find a fault in a microscope here and perhaps bring him back?
Actually, I think he has come around here and given some advice, and he knew what he was talking about. At least if we're to believe Leonard Brand, I think we can.
That'd be great to bring him to the science class.
Well, come on back for next week for Dino Next and Civility.